My name is Renno de Winter. As I told you, I'm from the Netherlands, and we're a fringe country in Europe. Self-proclaimed geek. I've been programming since I was 5 or 6 or something like that. And my main focus is on security and privacy. And what I do is I write, I train, and I consult. And as of yesterday, I am allowed to do once in a while a report for Dutch Business News Radio. So that's kind of cool, I think. And if you want to know more, buy me a beer. That always works and makes me talk. Torture doesn't work. Why are we here? The thing is that privacy and anonymity are really needed to safeguard free speech. I cannot do my job if I cannot count on those two. I've broken a lot of stories in the Netherlands, many of them making it to questions in parliament, sparking of debates, and even one vote of confidence for the Secretary of Transportation. Those things are only possible if I have people that are able to tell me what is going down. I cannot make that up myself. I could, but you know that you would be caught, and that wouldn't work. So, it's a whole thing about trust. And I know the most of you can't read Dutch. It has to do with Black Hat and yesterday. But this is what went down yesterday in the press room. I was sitting the entire day with my 3 colleagues from France at this table. Hell, I even gave them coffee. And they turn out to be snooping on you in a room where you expect to be non-part of the Black Hat network. Well, they didn't get anything from me, thank God. But still, you know, it didn't make me love the French more. So if there are any French, I'm sorry if I offended you, but you can always make up by buying me beer. But this is the whole thing what it's all about. You know, you need to be able to do your job knowing that you're safe. Why is this important for you? Well, give me a minute. The wake-up call is the thing that I want to tell you about. When I arrived last year in the Netherlands, I was arrested for making a photograph. I'll tell you all about it in a second. But that was for me the real wake-up call, and that was for me the thing that I started to understand that we needed to do something about this thing. I think I have an open source project that can make a difference, and if you're not interested in the project, at the very end I've got a couple of tips to help you out being a little bit more secure, because for me privacy is a very important part of security. So the wake-up call. This guy is not the guy that I was taken. He was quite okay me taking a picture, but when I returned from DEFCON one day later, I was walking in Utrecht, that's somewhere in the center of the Netherlands, and there was this guy coming by on a Segway. Now you know I'm a friend of David. There was this friend coming by on a Segway. And Segways were outlawed in the Netherlands. Why? We don't know, but it's kind of illegal. So if you see one coming by, you go like, oh cool, this is something for the blog I'm writing for. So I took a picture. He took offense, phoned the police, I was arrested, they took my camera and removed the picture. Sorry? He's saying the picture is right there. No, that's not the picture, this is a different guy after it all went down. Of course, what the police did was utterly illegal. But the fact is, the picture is gone, you don't have the evidence no more. This part of a big riot with a lot of blogs, with a lot of other journalists, and within 2 days the police started to apologize and, you know, they removed my record and they did everything to apologize. But it was a wake-up call. And after that we've seen a whole bunch of other incidents, and I want to walk through a couple of them. For instance, a cartonist that was supposed to be a racist, his cartons were taken offline without a court order. In a normal legal system, you would expect a judge to say, this is illegal, take it down. That's how a world should work. The same cartonist was jailed for days so that they could verify his identity. The funny thing was, they had verified his identity. well, I would call that bullying. In the public space, we have seen cameramen in the Netherlands being hindered doing their job. For instance, one of the instances, a journalist was filming an arrest, and they basically threatened to take his camera away. Well, we have the laptop searches at the border, and we have in the Netherlands policemen working and government workers full time on a whole bunch of websites looking for illegal remarks. I call them also thought police. And then one of the coolest things is we have got this website called No Style, and they got a summation from the police, give me the IP address of this movie that was posted. Somebody posted a movie that they were driving over 200 kilometers per hour. That's something like 150 miles or so. And that's kind of too fast. So if you're speeding, they want to know your IP address. That's kind of interesting. And last but not least, we had the movie of the politician that was made, and they tried to prevent that movie from being published. What else do we have? We've got massive monitoring using CCTV cameras. We've got public transportation cards that will store every move you make for at least 7 years. And we are introducing a tech system over the road, like Easy Pass or something like that, and that will photograph license plates. So if you come to the Netherlands and you go to the toilet, I will know about it. And last but not least, in the perfect fight against child pornography, they have put up a DNS system that will reroute you to police sites if you're visiting forbidden sites. Of course, this is very easy to circumvent, and they get very upset if you write about that, how to circumvent that. But the thing is, people think this is normal behavior. This is the scene I'm living in. And this is not the scene in the Netherlands alone. This is the scene in the UK, in Germany, in France. Well, let's not talk about that. And Spain and Italy. It's not all that different. The one difference is that in Germany, many of the things that they're trying to do are being stopped by a constitutional law, by a constitutional court. I wonder why. Probably the same reason why many of these things in Japan are stopped based on their constitution. So this is what I'm looking at, this is what I am up against. Oh, the thing that I want to do is get it right, and let's get it right on privacy and anonymity. First off, let's start off on a definition, because privacy is something else, and I'm very much aware that for you Americans, privacy has a whole different meaning than for a European. But scientists believe, and this is not what I thought of, but I learned from the University of Amsterdam, that privacy basically is the level of control you have over your own information. So when I get on a bus and they are registering that I'm traveling, I have no control over what people do with my information. If I happen to take the same bus as a notorious terrorist, I cannot oversee the consequences of that monitoring. If my cell phone is in a room with somebody that is wanted, like for 3 days, let's say on that one, I cannot oversee the consequences. And I'm not being afraid of being arrested, I'm far more afraid of the things that you cannot see. People that get sacked from their jobs, people that try to get a job and probably all of a sudden can't get it no more, people that are denied entry into other countries. And they don't know why they're on the list. We've got a European member of parliament, and she is being flagged every time she flies within the US. She doesn't know why, and she cannot change it. And we have the same thing in Europe. I mean, I'm not saying that we are so far more sacred than you are. Sorry about that. The other thing is anonymity. It's a whole different ball game. I decided, and that's my level of control, to say that my name is Brenno de Winter. I could have stand up here and say, I'm Snoop Doggy Dogg. I don't know if you would have believed me. But, you know, I could have been anonymous. I've chosen not to. That's a deliberate choice. People have a right, in many cases, to hide their identity. When I'm doing my job, I meet people all the time that do not want to tell me who they are. But they are giving me information that turns out to be true. That is why anonymity is important. People need to be able to go to a doctor and ask about a disease, you know, without telling if that's for themselves or for somebody else. And to show you the level of fear that we've got in our country, a couple of months ago I was working on this riot, and they did do a public bid that was very much debated in parliament, and somebody called me. I picked up my cell phone and could see a 070 number, that means The Hague. So he started telling his story, and then I said like, whoa, what's your name? And then he said like, I prefer not to tell. So I went like, yeah, but I see a phone number, you know, I can look this up really easy. And then he went like, that's because I'm in a bar, because I'm afraid. This is the level of care that we've already placed upon people. Somebody working for my government, leaving a cell phone at home, going to a bar to do this. And now we've got this new law called data retention. And I know somebody in this room is here and he's saying that data retention is a cool thing because you can find out so incredibly much. But this is a whole different ballgame, I think. The directive forces member nations of the European Union to introduce a law that will store IP addresses, phone numbers, who they belong to, who is calling whom when, who tries to call whom when, how long the call lasted, who is emailing whom, and who, you know, who is in charge or who is behind a certain address. And this is being used to prevent crime. Let me give you one example. Last year, and a beautiful blonde lady was taken out of her bed by the police because she apparently threatened our Prime Minister. I would say that's kind of stupid, you know, but there it is. After some time, the police find out they got the phone number wrong. She went public on television, and that's very good for the anti-data retention people, because nice, hard-working lady with children and looking nice, that always does it very, very well on television. But it shows the level of mistake. The second and last example on this one, a Dutch man doing business all of a sudden was arrested and detained for months because he had to be extradited to Greece. Apparently, he threatened somebody in Greece. What turned out to be the case is that there was this website that was illegal and his phone number happened to be on that website. How it got there, he really doesn't know because it wasn't his website. Only the phone number alone was reason to lock him up for months. That made me nervous, you know? A lot of people know my phone number. So if you hate me, no, let's not go there. The last thing, and that was actively said in Dutch parliament, what we can do with this information is predict who will commit a crime. Who did see Minority Report? But it is not only an issue for journalists, it's also people who want to tip off the police anonymously. Lawyers that need to be contacted by their clients. We have had several incidents in the Netherlands where the privilege, the private conversation between a lawyer and the defendant was actually violated. Priests and other people that are, you know, religious, and of course political activists. The downside is, oh, I'm not having luck with this today. Yeah, let me explain what's happening here. I normally work on a Mac, but last week on Thursday it surfaced that people in the US border can detain my laptop for indeterminate time. And I've got a lot of sensitive information that I really needed. I need to speak to some people and needed to bring along. So I bought a Windows laptop. And I use TrueCrypt to have the hidden partitions and stuff. If people want to search it now, it's too late. It's gone already because I did the talking about the documents already. You don't care about it until it hits you. And if you use tools to safeguard our privacy, they are generally user unfriendly. I expect everybody in this room to be able to install Freenet and Tor. I have a hard time asking this to my sister who is a physician. And let's not start with my mother that is 76 years old. It's way too complex. Many people are unaware. When I write down that they will store the data of where you're traveling on this little card for 7 years, I every time get new responses. And somebody wrote in a report that privacy wouldn't be an issue if the press wouldn't make it an issue. And then there's this other problem. I need to pick up a press badge later and then they will tell me again that I'm not allowed to take pictures without people's consent. Why? Because you can identify people on a picture. If I photograph 3 people on a picture, you still can identify them. But if I go into a stadium and stand on the central stage and then take a picture up, it's hard to identify anybody. The larger the group, the harder it is to identify who is doing what. The biggest help for privacy, without any doubt, is getting a large group of people using a tool. I don't really care if Tor is perfect or not. The thing is that if you own 1% of the network, apparently it's no longer secure. So with 6 billion people are running around, owning 1% is a lot harder than 130,000 users. That is the whole thing on the privacy part. So we need to get more people in. And then we have the whole thing that I told you about at the border, why I bought this different laptop just for this conference, to obfuscate data, because you don't want people at the border finding it. Of course, you can place a lot online, and that's what I would have done if that were possible, but in my case it wasn't. This is where I hope that my open source project can make a difference. First of all, I don't want to reinvent the wheel. There are a lot of good projects out there that I use on a daily basis. If I'm reinventing the wheel, I will fail in 2 ways. One is that the tool basically won't be as good as the other tools that are already out there. It will take longer. And second, I drive apart the community. And I just told you that you have to stand at the center stage of a big stadium and then make a picture. If you change, of course, you want to contribute back to other projects, that goes without saying. But we aim at a larger user base. And what I want to do is deliver tools that are easy to install, easy to work with, and most of all, work. And besides having the tool, you need to do a lot of marketing to get there. That's why I'm out here as well. And I hope to meet people after this talk that are willing to do a little bit. At this point, I've got over 100 people on my mailing list. And I can say that I've approximately 10 active contributors. What will the tool do? Well, in the beginning, 2 things. Enable email and chat by making that for the outside world anonymous. And for the inside world, you can choose. So when a message pops up in my email box, I either know who it's from, or it will be anonymous. And if it's totally anonymous, then of course you can select if you want to receive an anonymous email or not. No, I generally don't care about the spam messages too much. So if you not want to chase people away, you need to integrate with what you currently already have. Most people, whether you like it or not, are using Outlook. After nearly a week with this new computer, I wonder why, because I've got such a hard time working with it, but that's a whole different subject. But the reality is they are using it. I'm used to Thunderbird, and you can say from security sense that's not perfect, but, you know, it at least works for me. Many people are using messenger type of software. We need to perfectly integrate with that type of software in order to ensure that they can use the tools and they don't have to think about security. And the last but not least, if you have an Apple and you see the contact list application, you know it's a pretty good application. Maybe the interface could be a little bit better, but the good part of it, if when you install Skype, all the addresses are integrated. When you install other tools, it totally integrates. It blurs into the environment. Wouldn't it be nice to offer such a tool platform independent, for instance by using Python? What I want to do is encrypt messages, and maybe I should take a small step back. What is a message? A message is any type of communication, being a chat, being an email, but also being status information on what you're, for instance, what your system is doing or storing data in the cloud. If I can store a large chunk of data in the cloud, then I didn't have to buy a new laptop. I think OpenPGP, or more specifically GNUPG, is very good in making such message well protected. Second thing you want to do is use other hosts. If the gentleman with the red shirt over there would be so kind to put this data in the cloud, then it's pretty hard to know that I send the data off. Unless, of course, I send it directly, but that's why we've got Tor in this world. The next question is, how do you do that? Now, and what's the cloud? My cloud would be typically be Freenet, because that's the infrastructure that's already there to store data in the cloud and have it makes it very hard to take down, and after you're not using the data, it automatically falls off the cloud. Sounds funny when you say that. So you take Freenet to put data into the cloud. Using IDs and hashes, you can search the data, so you can see what files are there for me that are new, using some type of anonymity as well, of course, like Tor or anything else. But that basically means that you've created the route to put data in the cloud. Somebody else, whenever they are online, can take it out. They can take off a list, like, okay, I've got this message now, decrypt it and use it. I've been working on this very long. I had a whole different complex mechanism, and then I needed to know everybody that was around, and it had like a chat channel in it, and then a cryptographer said, like, why go so complex? And that's why I don't have a tool yet. And he pointed out that the complexity actually would make the project fail in the end. And this is kind of simple. You know, if I can reach somebody anonymous, if that person would be kind enough to put it online, if I can verify it anonymous that it is online after a certain time, the other person can pick it up at their leisure, yeah. And you don't need local storage or anything yourself, so, you know, when they take your laptop away, there is no evidence, besides part of a encrypted Freenet thing on your hard drive. Life sometimes can be so simple. Only creating the tools, that is of course not so simple. And what I thought of was this. You've got the cloud, you've got a small sister search engine. Well, I don't need to explain the name, small sister, I guess. And the communication engine will do all types of communication. It will retrieve the message from the email or the instant messenger, encrypt it, process it, place it on the network. The other one is the communicator itself, the program that you offer to people to maintain a contact list. The program that you offer to say, like, okay, we've got an alternative email solution if you want to, so that you're 100% sure that 100% of the messages are encrypted. And that basically should do the trick. Now, the communicator will be the hard part of the project. Because it needs, I don't know, a zillion plugins. It's a lot of work to get at least going and blurring into an environment. You know, and people are lazy, so you do want to make this as user-friendly as possible. So I would like to ask anybody who cares about it to at least join my mailing list. You know, because we need a lot of people to code, to do something about it, or to criticize me or other people in order to make sure that the technology works. And I feel one criticism coming up already that you can predict. One of the criticisms is, of course, you know, this technology is not 100% perfect. And this is where you have to make a security trade-off. Do I go for perfect technology that makes 100% sure that nobody can find out? Or am I going for the big crowd and thus ensuring the privacy? It may be very clear what choice I made. So, we need users, we need doers. So if you feel like it, go to www.smallsister.org, subscribe to the mailing list. Now if you want to protect you think, okay, guy, you're bullshitting, you're from the Netherlands, you can't help it, that's it. Don't worry about it. Do something yourself that makes little tips. One of the things I did is, like 4 years ago, write an article, 10 ways to circumvent data retention. That took the Minister of Justice to an emergency debate in Parliament, because all of a sudden politicians started realizing that probably this is not the best way to secure ourselves, and probably it's easy to circumvent. You know what happened in that debate? They said, like, yeah, but the stupid people will still be, you know, caught. Started off as terrorists and now we're down to stupid people. That's kind of interesting. And that made me realize, when I was preparing this talk, that made me realize that we've got a fair chance of undoing the harm for a part. Not only by using the tool, but showing the tool and say, like, well, what are we doing? This is so simple to circumvent. This is so simple to overcome. Why are we spending precious legal resources on this? We've got a shortage of policemen. Last year in the Netherlands alone, and we are a nation of 60 million people, 423 cases of child pornography did not make it because police was lacking people. We cannot throw scarce resources away. So we might overcome this, actually. One of the funny things is, if you want to be anonymous and you want to do something that might trigger attention, is go to your neighbor. In my case, I need to go 5 houses down the road, but then I can serve for free. Yeah, but that's illegal, I know, but you know, if I'm using my cell phone, my iPhone, would the police really know if I'm serving the T-Mobile network in the Netherlands, or would they really think like, oh, he's serving anonymously? And of course, it's smarter to go to a different city, etc. But that's one of the things that might obfuscate it, and that's also one of the dangers. Because if you're searching for instance, Semtex bomb and airplane using Google, and if they can see that search, that would raise attention. Only it would draw the attention to the wrong persons. Second one is use a prepaid GSM. In the Netherlands, or you use it, you call it pay as you go, right? In the Netherlands, you can still buy it anonymously, and I tried it, and at this store they said, like, yeah, but you have our discount card. So I went like, oh, I would like to have an anonymous discount card, please. So I got an anonymous discount card, bought the phone, it worked great. The only thing was, when the lady was packing up the bag and giving me the phone, she said, like, there you go, Mr. De Winter. She turned out to be somebody I was in school with, so, yeah. Anonymity doesn't always work. Then actually you should leave the phone lying around for a couple of months, because they have camera images of you, and then you have a fair chance of communicating anonymously. Be aware if you do that. Be aware that you can trace devices very well. So if you have your regular cell phone on and your prepaid GSM, and you do that for 3 days, it's kind of easy to find out that that that's you, especially if you call all the same numbers over and over again. One of the things, and I've been doing that and testing that a lot, is using SSH or crypto tunnels towards non-European servers. And the funny thing is, then you're outside of the legal jurisdiction and you're gone. If you have a closed service, and this is really funny, if you're in the Netherlands, if you have a closed service, like my small sister project is not for everybody, but everybody minus one, then it's closed service, and then you can say like, oh, we don't maintain logs, we don't do that. So that undermines the effectivity as well, but it also helps. And of course, if you don't want to use small sister, use Tor, use off, or use Freenet. Use tools that are available. Yeah, but you know, I don't really need to do that. Do it for the other people. Make the crowd bigger. Then a couple of things of the obvious. I've got nothing to hide. I don't know if you read Bruce Nye's blog, but last week he had this link up to a professor that was telling why you shouldn't talk to the police. And my good friend Don Blumenthal in the audience will tell why you will tell later today or tomorrow that why you should talk to the police. But he mentioned at a certain point that there were 10,000 laws of federal level in the US alone. So if you don't do anything illegal, you know a lot about law. That would make you a very, very, very intelligent person, which of course we all are. I always wonder if people have nothing to hide. A couple of months ago I was giving a lecture and then somebody said like, I've got nothing to hide. So I asked him what his name was and I started Googling him and showing a couple of his child pictures, and then he got very upset with me. So apparently he did want to hide his childhood. I've met this guy, he's a lawyer, and he was in a radio show in the Netherlands, and at a certain point he was talking about anonymous blogging. And this show host confronted him with a remark he made 17 years earlier, that he thought he should be able to have a sexual relationship with a 15-year-old boy. He's gay. That in itself would be very illegal in the Netherlands. The fact, however, is that he was just 16. And that changes the dynamic and the context a lot. It's not right, but it's a whole different context all of a sudden. However, 17 years later, he looks like a pedophile. So that simple remark that was still available through Google turned out something you really had to hide. At that point, it looked very innocent. I'm not sure that what I'm saying today and what I'm telling and talking to people and the things that I do today are still legal tomorrow. And I always wondered, like, okay, from whom have you got something to hide? I've got a lot to hide from you. For instance, the names of my sources. I get a lot of questions, especially from Dutch government workers, don't you trust your government? Don't you trust your prime minister? Don't you trust your minister of the interior? And I always say I trust them fully. Like my family trusted their government in 1939. I don't trust my government in 2013 because I don't know it. My family never got to see the government that was there after 1945. That is the issue. You are not hiding, you're protecting your data. Having said that, that is basically the thing that I wanted to share with you. I'm kind of early. I'm a quick talker, I guess. So if there are any questions, I would be happy to take them, and I believe that afterwards there is also room in a Q&A room. And if you want to debate it more, I would really, really love to do so. So I don't know if there are any questions. Yeah. Okay, I get the question, like we have got like conservatives in Canada and things in America, and now you have this whole story about police watching websites and what happened. I think what happened, and this is pure speculation, but I think what happened is that the Dutch government and other governments were very much behind on technology. You know, and we've got a when I sometimes write an article and, you know, you phone a politician and say like, hey, what do you think of it? Oh, that's outrageous! I need to ask questions in Parliament. And then the politicians go like, yeah, something needs to be done about it right now. And then something happens. You know, I guess that's part of it. Like, oh, it's only website, it's not language, you should take it down. And the other, and we're trying to find a way how to deal with that. I think we're going through a very important phase at this moment. So that's one. And the other thing what happened is, I think there's a hunger for control. Controlling what you cannot control. You had a question? Yes, there's a big difference between privacy in America and Europe. Absolutely true. The thing is, in Europe, the data that you store and is like my name and my date of birth is my data. If I go into a store and there hangs a camera, by legal right, I can ask them, send me the images of me. Nobody does it, but you can. In the US, it's like if you store a database with my data, it's your database. Thank God you've got an agency like the FTC that cracks down on it when something goes really wrong. But you know, if it goes wrong like in the smaller, like of only a couple of hundred people, you're screwed. You know, your fingerprint is not being regarded as privacy-sensitive information. With your fingerprint and a registration in the Netherlands, I can spend your money. Because they only verify it on the fingerprint. So I don't know if you like what you eat, if you eat kosher or halal, if that is something that would be privacy sensitive. But by nature it is, because it says a lot about your religion. Potentially says a lot about your religion, of course. Yes. Yes, he's saying that. Oh, yes, he's pointing out the structural issue that is there. That I said, like Germany and Japan are stopping a lot of the privacy erosion going on, and he's pointing out that they are mainly based on the U.S. Bill of Rights, which is absolutely true. I've met people here that say that there has been an erosion in the U.S. as well. Actually, I had a friend who put the Constitution on eBay, apparently because the Americans are not needing it anymore. So, yeah. Yeah, well, he's a great guy, by the way, but that's all different. Any other questions? I'm done early. Normally they have to drag me down. Okay. Well, thank you very much for your attention. I really, really hope that you at least consider visiting the website, lurk on the mailing list at least, or maybe do a contribution. And not just for me, but I think for a lot of people that are unaware of the issue right now. Thank you.